worship our Lord and Savior today.
There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain.
There's freedom though you captured me.
I've got joy instead of mourning. There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain.
There's freedom though you captured me.
I've got joy instead of mourning. 'Cause you give me joy. Down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. There's beauty in my brokenness. I've got true love instead of pain.
There's freedom though you captured me.
I've got joy instead of mourning. 'Cause you give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul.
Never been so free, ignoring your love for me. Never been more secure, knowing your heart, Lord.
Never been so free, caught in your love for me. Never been more secure, knowing your heart, Lord. Never been so free, caught in your love for me. Never been more secure, knowing your heart, Lord. Never been so free, caught in your love for me. Never been more secure.
You give me
joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. You give me joy down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul, down deep in my soul. Father
God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this moment that we can celebrate you and what you've done on the cross. Father God, we glorify your name, and we pray that the church is edified and that you are ultimately glorified. Father God, in your name we pray. Amen.
Well, all right, church. Welcome. Glad that you would join us this morning. And I just want to say thank you for joining us this morning. You have plenty of options, I'm certain, to check out. You could even check out stuff on TV or hop on Facebook and probably find a lot of other churches trying to broadcast. A lot of pastors are now turning into televangelists. And so a lot of people are joining up and looking on and trying to find. And so just thank you. Thank you that you're tuning in with us. There's a lot of places you could be listening to, and I thank you for being a part of us and our family. Also, I just want to share with you that on Thursdays, we do Zoom prayer meetings. And so you're all welcome to join us in that as well. And if you've never done a Zoom prayer meeting, then you're exactly the person that I'm trying to talk to, actually. And so I just need an email, and then we can communicate about how to make that happen. And so we've had a couple of these already, and we're anticipating on doing a few more. And so we would hope that you would join in. It'd be great to see a lot of your faces. It's pretty good time. We've had people from Alaska and Connecticut and Oregon and Canada and Pennsylvania and all throughout Florida join us in our prayer meetings. And so I want to invite you as well. And you can simply look up us online, give me your email, and I'll put you on the loop to be able to join us on Thursday evenings. Today, we are in our message and through our sermons, we are ending on 1 Corinthians study. 16 chapters in 1 Corinthians, and we've completed that today. After the message today, we'll be done with 1 Corinthians. So what does that mean? That means we want to continue on into 2 Corinthians. So our soap scripture for next week is 2 Corinthians chapter 1. And so we invite you to soap the scripture. You know the scripture. Observe, analyze, and pray about that. So that's the soap. And so if you're a part of who we are as a church, or if you're interested in joining us and what we're doing and how we're going through the scriptures and through the Bible, be a part of who we are and soap the scriptures this very week, 2 Corinthians chapter 1. All right. Also, one of the things we do here in the church is we put people in the doghouse. And so this week in the doghouse, we have a picture. We got a picture of John Josephson. John Josephson is in the doghouse. And John Josephson's been hanging around this church for, most of his life, if not all of it up to this point. And so he's been familiar with many people and many things that have taken place over in this congregation over decades and decades. And so, John, we just love you. We appreciate you. He always helps out on Sunday mornings. He's helping out in the Sunday cafe many times. He pops in on Sunday school often. And he's always been a part of our Thanksgiving dinners that we've been doing here in the church. And if I'm not mistaken, John, we're counting on you again this year. We don't know what it's going to look like, but hopefully Thanksgiving time will look like a great celebration and a great feast where we can all be together again. And John, we're going to be counting on you as well to be a part of our family and a part of that feast. So would you join me and let's pray for our dear brother, John Josephson. Let's pray. Pray with me. Father in heaven, I just come before you and thank you so very much for my brother John. Father, for the years that he has walked this campus, you have known him. And Father, you have worked in him and you have ministered into his life. And Father, I would pray that you might continue the good works that you've begun within his heart and the very depths of his soul. That he would be a transformed man, that is a man that walks for Jesus. And so, Father, I pray that as you work in him, that you would work through him, that the places that he would venture and the places that he would go, the Holy Spirit would go before. And, Father, that he would be a light and a testimony and a witness to all those that are around him about what Christ can do in someone's life. I thank you, Father, for his community service, the way he serves the church and tries and makes efforts to help other people. Father, continue to uphold him physically, financially, emotionally, keep him straight, looking at you, Father, and spiritually make him grow deeper by your Holy Spirit. And so, Father, as we come before you with thanksgiving and praise for our brother John, join me in saying amen. And if you see John out there and about, just say, hey, I've been praying for you, and I hope that you would pray for him this week. Hey, I just want you to know that, you know, church is still kind of keeping on, keeping on. Ministry and outreach is still taking place. And so one of the things that that the Lord kind of shared with me, it's scripture, it's let us not grow used to the habit of not meeting. And so this was one of the things that the Lord was laying on my heart. This would be very easy to kind of get used to, right? Just sitting at home in your pajamas and, you know, sipping coffee or muting the pastor anytime you want to. You don't like the message or the words he's saying, just mute him. Or you just get up and leave or change the channel or flip onto something else in Facebook, you know. We should not get used to the habit of not meeting. While this is awkward and unusual, and this is the thing, we need to be assembled together. You've heard me say it countless times before. You don't need the church, you don't need the congregation, you don't need the fellowship to have a relationship with God. You don't. You don't need the church and the fellowship to have a relationship with God. But you'll never be all that God wants you to be outside of His fellowship. Fellowship is extraordinarily important. It is essential to the growth of a Christian. And when I was thinking about that this morning, the Lord told me this. While you can survive in isolation, you will not thrive in isolation. It's just another way of saying, you don't need the church to have a relationship with God, but you'll never be all God wants you to be outside of His fellowship and outside of His church. For those that know the values of fellowship and desire to be all that God wants them to be, they're hungry to get back into fellowship. They're hungry to get back into the church. And I hope that you're hungry as well to get back into the church. And the church has not ceased to continue to do that which the fellowship continues to do. There was a wedding here this week in the sanctuary on holy ground. A wedding was here. Yesterday, Lakeim Messianic Congregation held their services in a Holocaust remembrance service. Church is still taking place. Prayer every week, every other day here from the Spanish church. They're here. They're praying. They're waiting for fellowship and God to move in a mighty and a powerful way. Yesterday, I did a graveside funeral service for a longtime resident at Lake Clark Shores. So all that to say that the church carries on, the church continues, that this sanctuary, this sanctified, hallowed ground continues to do the good works of Jesus Christ. And so in that, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for your continued support that this campus can continue to operate. Love each of you, miss each and every one of you, and I can't wait to see you again, maybe a little bit closer. In the meantime, God bless you, and hey, check this out.
Giving back to God in whatever way He tells you, 10% of what you Malachi 3:10 says, "Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it." Let's see what that means. Manna and milk each had 10 marshmallows that they have earned or received as part of the stimulus check. Well, if they were to tithe 10%, Nosipa, would you help me with it? Thank you. They would say, for example, give one marshmallow to the church. That helps pay for things for the church, maybe helps give people food. Thank you, Manner and Mel. All right, that leaves 9 marshmallows. Next, they would use 5 of these things for things like groceries, electric bills, rent, new tires on a bike. Maybe a video game. Oh, look! They still have... Wow, they're really using up that money, aren't they? They have 4... Manor has 4 marshmallows left. Mel, how you doing? How you doing over there? Mel has 5 marshmallows left. But look, we have 2 very sad little animals that are hungry and have no food. 2 Corinthians 9. Manner's been working very hard. He's got a lot of marshmallows. 2 Corinthians 9:7 says, "Each of you should give what you decided."
Welcome back, everyone. I have to confess, I've been getting a little cranky and a little down this past week. I'm really starting to miss all you. But I really love God's word. I love praising his name, being in his house in worship. Psalms 27 says, "One thing I ask from the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set my feet on a high rock."
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Father, we just exalt your name today. We thank you, Father, for your triumph over the grave. Thank you, Father, for bringing us into the throne room. Thank you for our eternal salvation in Christ Jesus.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, I see many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, but I know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To one. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To one. Love so undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me, deeper still into love, 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 love. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you. You give light, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. it's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
Shouts your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry. These bones will sing. Great.
Bones will sing. Great are you, Lord.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out. So we pour out our praise to you.
We pour out our praise.
It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you,
dear friend, Pastor Gurgis. Say a prayer for us, brother.
Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning and we give you honor and the glory. We honor you. We love you. You are here in our heart. We thank you because we always have the privilege to call you Abba, Father. And we have the privilege and the honor you listening to us. When we are weak, you are strong. When we need you, Lord, we find you anywhere, anytime. You answer our prayer. We give you thanks for everything you have done for us. Thank you for the protection you gave it to us in these days. Lord, we pray to protect your people, protect your nation. Protect us from the coronavirus and bring the church back, the body of the Christ. We see each other. We miss those days, Lord, to see every one of us. Now we're going to see differently. We're not going to see anybody with his bad stuff. We're going to see everybody with good stuff. Because we know we don't have anybody in this earth other than our family, the church people, church body. We honor every one of them. We appreciate every one of them. We respect every one of them. We forgive every one of them. This is all the church about. As you love us with no condition, we're going to love our people in the church with no condition. Our eyes going to be to you. Bless this church. Bless Pastor Stan. Bless everybody's here. And everybody's watching us and listening to us. Bless them, Jesus. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ. I pray that the church is edified so that we may all stand firm in our faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, who was and is to come. Today we're looking at the final chapter of 1 Corinthians, where Paul is giving instruction, as he has been, to the church in Corinth, and he also gives us a little glimpse into his personal journey, which I find pretty neat. I always like that. But I'm going to pull up 1 Corinthians 16 and read it right now. Starting at verse 1. Now about the collection for the Lord's people, do what I told the Galatian churches to do. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income, saving it up so that when I come, no collections will have to be made. Then, when I arrive, I will give letters of introduction to the men you approve and send them with your gift to Jerusalem. If it seems advisable for me to go also, they will accompany me. After I go through Macedonia, I will come to you, for I will be going through Macedonia. Perhaps I will stay with you for a while or even spend the winter so that you can help me on my journey wherever I go. For I do not want to see you now and make only a passing visit. I hope to spend some time with you if the Lord permits. But I will stay on at Ephesus until Pentecost, because a great door for effective work has opened to me, and there are many who oppose me. When Timothy comes, see to it that he has nothing to fear while he is with you, for he is carrying on the work of the Lord, just as I am. No one, then, should treat him with contempt. Send him on his way in peace so that he may return to me. I am expecting him along with the brothers. Now about your brother Apollos, I strongly urged him to go to you with the brothers. He was quite unwilling to go now, but he will go when he has the opportunity. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. Do everything in love. You know that the household of Stephanas, however you want to say it, were the first converts in Achaia, and they have devoted themselves to the service of the Lord's people. I urge you, brothers and sisters, to submit to such people and to everyone who joins in the work and labors at it. I was glad when Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Achaicus arrived, because they have supplied what was lacking from you. For they refreshed my spirit and yours also. Such men deserve recognition. The churches in the province of Asia send you greetings. Aquila and Priscilla greet you warmly in the Lord, and so does the church that meets at their house. All the brothers and sisters here send you greetings. Greet one another with a holy kiss. I, Paul, write this greeting in my own hand. If anyone does not love the Lord, let that person be cursed. Come, Lord. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with you. My love to all of you in Christ Jesus. Amen. So I pray all is well, and we get a glimpse into Paul's ministry. We get a glimpse into the people, the relationships he's built, conversations he may have had with the other apostles, as well as other within the ministry. And this message is going to hopefully be short and sweet. And basically what I'm going to do is walk through the scripture and give it some context and preach on two particular verses which are great reminders to the saints no matter where we are in our spiritual journey. It's always nice to go back to the basics. The church in Corinth, as Paul says, was an infant within the context of their spiritual journey. They weren't ready for solid food yet. They were still on milk. They hadn't gotten the basics down. They were merely adolescent in their faith, which Paul says is fine, but they ultimately needed guidance. So we have an idea that they have sent a few letters to the Apostle Paul and asking how they are to do certain things, and we've walked entirely through Paul's first reply in 1 Corinthians, and this is the last chapter. Paul has been mercifully guiding the Corinthians through ecclesiology and the theology of the resurrection, as well as how to apply all of this within the heart and outwardly to have an effect on their lives as well as others. We're finally at this last chapter, and here we see Paul giving instruction on giving or tithing, his travel plans, his request, his final exhortations, and finally his ending greeting and his signature. So let's walk through this starting at verse 1. Now about the collection for the Lord's people, do what I told the Galatian churches to do. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income, saving it up so that when I come, no collections will have to be made. Then when I arrive, I will give letters of introduction to the men you approve and send them with your gifts to Jerusalem. If it seems advisable for me to go also, they will accompany me. Verses 1 through 4 of chapter 16 flow very logically out of Paul's teaching on the resurrection in chapter 15. Paul concluded by assuring the Corinthian saints that due to the resurrection of our Lord, and thus the resurrection of the dead, our labor is not in vain. Our labor is in the Lord. No wonder Paul can now speak to his readers about making a contribution to the poor. This is one of the ways the Christian can, as Jesus says, lay up their treasure in heaven. There are all kinds of people seeking contributions. You don't have to drive very far. You don't have to drive very many blocks before we find men and sometimes women and children sitting or standing on the median with signs pronouncing their need for money. But the need which occasions Paul's instructions is a special one. Jerusalem at the time we understand, was going through a famine as well as there was persecution going on. The stoning of Stephen brought about a persecution which forced many to flee from Jerusalem, as we saw in Acts chapter 8. The means of meeting the needs of the poor saints in Jerusalem have been depleted in the church that was there. At the same time, things were becoming tough for, at the same time as things were becoming tough for the Jewish saints, things were also becoming very difficult for Jews elsewhere. The famine which Agabus and other prophets predicted took place during the reign of Claudius, as we see in Acts chapter 11. It was Claudius who, during his reign, ordered the Jews out of Rome in Acts chapter 18, which is why Priscilla and Aquila met up with Paul in Corinth. Jewish believers elsewhere in the world were having hard times on their own, so they were not able to do much to help their brethren in Jerusalem and Judea. We have a text from the book of Hebrews that seems to best describe the situation that was going on in Jerusalem and Judea, and I'm going to read it to you. It is out of Hebrews chapter 10, verses 32 through 35. Again, this is just sort of a description of what was going on at the time in Jerusalem and Judea. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 32 through 35. But remember the former days when, after being enlightened, you endured a great conflict of sufferings, partly by being made a public spectacle through reproaches and tribulations, and partly by becoming sharers with those who were so treated. For you showed sympathy to the prisoners and accepted joyfully the seizure of your property, knowing that you have for yourselves a better possession and an abiding one. Therefore, do not throw away your confidence, which has a great reward. So we see Paul here giving instructions to the people at the church in Corinth on how to save their money, what to do with it, and how to give it so that it may be sent at the proper time to those in need in Jerusalem. So even back then, the churches all around were helping those in need. All throughout history, starting at the first century, the people of the one and only true living God were helping those for the greater good, and that was God's plan. The body of Christ has done amazing things for cultures around the world by leading social change. It was Christians who stopped infanticide in its tracks, where people would sacrifice their babies to fertility gods for their own purposes, which were rather in vain. Yet, unfortunately, today we see many Christians supporting a modern-day approach to infanticide, abortion, and thinking it's okay when it's truly not, because that baby is formed, and God knows that baby, and that baby is made in the image of God, which gives it and all of us intrinsic value, which is why we should not murder, which is exactly what abortion is. It was a Christian by the name of William Wilberforce who led the movement to abolish the slave trade because he knew these people had value. Why? Because whether you are black, white, Asian, Haitian, Vietnamese, Hebrew, Arabic, etc., you are still made in the image of God. You have value, church, and the church, the body of Christ, have been the people behind social change in the past who actually banded together with the aim of peace in order to make change that is beneficial to the common good. I mean, look at Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King. His letter from a Birmingham prison is so prolifically written, and he also preaches in that letter on the intrinsic value of all human beings for being made in the image of God. But it's sad that many people drop the Reverend before Doctor. They don't remember that Dr. Martin Luther King was a pastor first. He was aligned with Christ. He was empowered by the Holy Spirit to do what he did. And all these things couldn't have been done by one person alone, though. They were done with the backing of the body of believers. And remember, Jesus says that when two or more are gathered, he is amongst them, and they will be called his church. All this to say that churches should be the leaders behind good social change. Maybe not some of the garbage that's going around now, but good social change for the common good, as we discussed before in 1 Corinthians. And the church should be leaders in culture. But the church also has its needs, whether it be financial or even availability. It is important. Paul saw the importance of tithing, of giving. Because the church wants to make change. The church wants to change culture, but we have needs and resources that need to be met as well. So tithing is important. And I would also argue the availability to serve is important. At this point, Paul is instructing them on how they should manage their funds so that there is funds available for the church in Jerusalem who is struggling to serve the people there who are going through this rough time. Nevertheless, we do have opportunities to respond to Paul's instructions. The church is not just the local church, but it is the body of Christ. It is alive. The body of Christ certainly includes those who profess faith in Christ around the world. At this very moment, Christians are living in very similar straits to the Jewish saints of Jerusalem and Judea in Paul's day. Amazing as it may seem, in this age of instant communications, we are less aware of our impoverished and persecuted brethren than were those in Paul's day, for whom the speed of our current mail system, email, would boggle their minds. It's fast. We are obligated to be aware of the needs of our brothers and sisters in distant places and to minister to their material needs. Thank God for the Christian and Missionary Alliance, because we have an emphasis on missionaries and we try to give financially to those who need it. And we try to provide resources for those out in the field. Praise God. But I'm going to move on. Starting at verse 5, after I go through Macedonia, I will come to you, for I will be going through Macedonia. Perhaps I will stay with you for a while, or even spend the winter, so that you can help me on my journey wherever I go. For I do not want to see you now and make only a passing visit. I hope to spend some time with you. If the Lord permits, but I will stay on at Ephesus until Pentecost, because a great door for effective work has opened to me, and there are many who oppose me. That's interesting. I'll admit to you, when I first read this, I didn't know where to go when it came to preaching on this. I didn't know what points I could have. And unfortunately, I don't have points on a screen because I couldn't really pinpoint it. That wasn't where this sermon was going as I was spending time with the Lord. But I figured it was better just to kind of go through it. But the first thing that Paul says is that he doesn't simply just want to pass through. Why? Because he actually wants to spend some genuine time with them and get things back on track if he can, rather than go for such a quick visit and get nothing done. Maybe he was afraid if he went for a quick visit, people would end up glorifying Paul rather than glorifying the Lord. I don't know exactly. But he actually wants to spend genuine time with them. Paul was very strategic when it came to his church planting, and Corinth wasn't next. At the time he was writing this letter, he was in Ephesus, which is in Asia Minor and across the Aegean Sea. So it would take a considerable amount of time and resources for him to actually make it over there. He couldn't jump on a plane. He couldn't catch a cab, call an Uber. He couldn't do any of that. Plus, it would take boat travel, which was only available during certain seasons around that time. Another thing that stuck out to me here was that he chose to stay in Ephesus. Why? Because a great door, quote, a great door for effective work was open to him, and there were many there who opposed Paul. Even in Corinth, there were many who mocked Paul and opposed him, even telling the church that he would never return, which wasn't true. People were telling the church, people of the world were trying to instill hopelessness amongst the church in Corinth. But Paul knew that when the Lord called him to, he was going to be in Corinth. In Corinth again, too. An opportunity. Paul says there are many who oppose him, and instead of leaving, he calls it an open door, an opportunity. When was the last time you came into contact with someone who completely thinks your ideas are hoopla? They think you're crazy, but you saw it as a complete opportunity for the Holy Spirit to change a heart. That's what Paul is doing here. If anything, that's how we should view such people. If anything, debate helps us grow. Don't be afraid of it. Challenging your own beliefs helps us grow. We've become too complacent and too comfortable that we've gotten to the point that when someone says something, whether it's true or not, that's may be offensive to the Christian culture, that may be offensive to a Christian, that Christian now has shaky ground and doesn't know how to defend himself. That person's faith is shaken. And unfortunately, some people, whenever they get into such a situation, they don't know what to believe anymore. That comes from two things: the lack of our schools teaching critical thinking, as well as believers not being challenged enough, because we want to stay in our bubbles. We don't want to be uncomfortable. But let me ask you something. How is the gospel going to be preached if we are not bold? How are we to know what's true if we can't think critically enough to look at facts objectively and see things for what they really are? Jesus came to make the comfortable uncomfortable, but he also came to make the uncomfortable comfortable. Jesus came to make the comfortable uncomfortable, and he also came to make the uncomfortable comfortable. As we'll read later, we need to stand firm in our faith and be courageous. Moving on, when Timothy comes, see to it that he has nothing to fear while he is with you, for he is carrying on the work of the Lord just as I am. No one then should treat him with contempt. Send him on his way in peace so that he may return to me. I am expecting him along with the brothers. Now about our brother Apollos, I strongly urged him to go to you with the brothers. He was quite unwilling to go now, but he will go when he has the opportunity. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. And do everything in love. Here we go, the magnum opus of this chapter, the magnum opus of this entire letter. Paul's brief statements here summarize the entire work. These two verses may not seem to say much at first glance, but they appear to sum up the application that Paul has been saying in this epistle. The resurrection of the dead assures us of the second coming of our Lord. Just as our Lord warned the disciples to be on the alert and not to be surprised by his return, so Paul gives the same admonition. Be alert, be on your guard. Here's two texts that I think more explains what Paul's trying to say to the Corinthians in these last statements. And this first one comes from Matthew chapter 24, verses 42 through 44. Matthew chapter 24, verses 42 through 44. Therefore, be on the alert, for you do not know which day your Lord is coming. But be sure of this, that if the head of the house had known at what time of the night the thief was coming, he would have been on the alert and would not have allowed his house to be broken into. For this reason, you be ready too, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour when you do not think he will. Again, that was Matthew chapter 24, verses 42 through 44. The next text I have is 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 2 through 6. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 2 through 6. For you yourselves know full well that the day of the Lord will come, just like a thief in the night. While they are saying peace and safety, then destruction will come upon them suddenly like birth pangs upon a woman with child, and they shall not escape. But you, brethren, are not in darkness, that the day should overtake you like a thief. For you are all sons of light and sons of day. We are not of night nor of darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us be alert and sober. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 2 through 6. One could hardly say that the Corinthians were on their guard or on the alert. Some were denying the resurrection of the dead completely. They were surely not living as though the Lord's return was at hand and as though he would judge them according to their deeds. They did not even recognize God's judgment among them at that time. They were tolerant to one living in shocking sin, as we saw in chapter 5. They were tolerant to taking one another to court, as we saw in chapter 6. And they were tolerant in participating in heathen idol worship rituals. It was time for them to wake up. Church, I think it's time for us to wake up. The Corinthians were challenged by Paul to stand firm in the faith. It is all too obvious that false teachers were among them. False teachers were there. The gospel message by which they were saved was being looked down upon as something less than the new wisdom that had been introduced. Fundamentals of the gospel, for example, the resurrection of the dead, were being forsaken. Another gospel was tolerantly accepted instead. These saints needed to stand firm in the faith which Paul and the other true apostles had delivered to them. They needed to believe in the right gospel, the correct gospel, that Jesus rose from the grave. The Corinthians were challenged to be courageous, or some translations say, act like men. Now, this is really interesting. It's an enlightening statement. We need some context behind it, but what does he mean by this? It's not hard to grasp in the light of chapters 11 through 14. We saw in chapters 11 through 14 there was a role reversal going on in Corinth. Women were casting off the symbols and the substance of their femininity. At the same time, it looks like the men were relinquishing their roles and responsibilities as men. I think Paul is challenging the men to assume their God-given responsibilities and to assume the leadership in their church and in their homes. Also, the Corinthians were encouraged to be strong. I find this ironic because the Corinthians despised weakness. They hated weakness. If you were weak, you were basically scum. This is what they did not like about the gospel or Paul. See, God uses the weak things to demonstrate his strength. Let me say that again. God uses the weak things to demonstrate his strength. By thinking and acting like those who were strong, those who were quote unquote strong, the Corinthians were showing themselves to be spiritually weak. Paul was urging them to be strong in the Lord. And this would mean forsaking their human and culturally approved strengths. These people who thought themselves strong and Paul weak were the ones who needed to be strong. Finally, Paul exhorts the Corinthians to do everything they do in love. Here we find one of the vital ingredients to the Christian life as discussed before, but it's obviously missing at the church in Corinth. Paul had to devote an entire chapter to its description, as we see in chapter 13, the love chapter. These saints were obviously lacking in love toward God and toward men. Love would radically change the church at Corinth. Love would radically change your church at home. Love would radically change the world. And that is 1 Corinthians in a nutshell. But is this text only applicable to the people in Corinth? No! We, church, need to be on alert and on our guard. As mentioned before, we are going to be attacked. People are looking to offend you. Christians have been persecuted since the beginning of the apostolic church era in the first century. We need to be on guard and learn to defend our faith. We need to guard our hearts and not be vulnerable to the influence of the world because it wants to take it away from God. It wants to take your heart away from God. It wants to unalign you from him. See, it's unwise for an army to be on the total offense and not guard what is precious. It's unwise for a military to not be on guard, just as it is unwise for us as people involved in spiritual warfare to not be on guard. We must be on guard and be on defense, and not only that, but we need to build our defense, because believe me, the world's offense is only getting stronger. And we can build our defense by reading material that challenges our faith, by debating with those politely who are lost and do not believe in God or believe in false gods. We can build our defense by actually reading our Bibles. That's a step. This way, through our defense, we can actually stand firm in our faith. We can have confidence in the faithfulness of God. He will fulfill his promises. We can have confidence in the strength of our mighty God. We can have confidence in the resurrection because it happened Folks, no one has disproved the resurrection. No one can disprove the resurrection. No one will disprove the resurrection. Why? Because it happened, and it is the truth. And the burden of proof goes on those who reject the truth. We need to stand firm in our faith. We can't be 50% in and 50% out. The resurrection should be everything to you. It should be your backdrop in life. It should be the basis on which you make every decision in your life. We can't be those whose seeds took root on rocky ground. We need to be those who are planted firmly in the Lord's good soil, the Lord's pure soil, the rich soil, so we can bear fruit. There are too many shaky Christians out there who say that they are believers but flirt with the world and side with the world when the worst takes place. There are too many of those who would mimic what Peter did when he denied knowing Jesus when they're facing persecution. We must also be courageous and strong in our faith. I feel as though we have lost the concept behind the mightiness of God and replaced it with all this mushy love stuff, which I'm not completely putting it down, but our God is real love, agape love, who is mighty and an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns. He is our source of strength, and by his power alone conquered death and the grave. No matter how muscular you are, no matter how smart you are, no matter how wise you are, try resurrecting on your own. Try resurrecting on your own after you are dead. Try it. I don't care if you're the strongest man in the world. I don't care if you're the smartest person in the world. It won't happen. If we are on God's side, we have to be on God's side. He will be on ours. Our hearts will be aligned. He will use you, church. Lastly, everything we do, church, must be in love. Not lustful love, not brotherly love, but unconditional, sacrificial love. Without God, there is no love. And sometimes, unfortunately, we see that within the church, which has chased people away rather than draw them near to the beautiful work of Jesus Christ on the cross. I mean, would Christ have died on the cross if it weren't for love? And that love displayed for us on the cross is why we preach 2,000 years later, because it leads to something greater. It leads to better outcomes. It leads to others. It leads others to love those that they never thought they would. It leads us to the greatest good that will ever exist, the greatest good ever, and that is God. And he is the standard as to which we love, for without him, there is no morale, there is no peace, and there is no love. But we learn from God. We learn from Paul in 1 Corinthians that love lasts forever, because our God is love. Our God is the embodiment of love. Our God is good. And God loves you not because you're good, but because he is good. William Gladstone, in announcing the death of Princess Alice to the House of Commons, told a touching story. The little daughter of the princess was seriously ill with diphtheria. The doctors told the princess not to kiss her little daughter and endanger her life by breathing the child's breath. Once, when the child was struggling to breathe, the mother, forgetting herself entirely, took the little one into her arms to keep her from choking to death. Rasping and struggling for her life, the child said, "Mama, Mama, kiss me." Without thinking of herself, the mother tenderly kissed her daughter. She got diphtheria, and some days thereafter, she went to be forever with the Lord. Real love forgets self. Real love knows no danger. Real love doesn't count the cost. The Bible says, many waters cannot quench love, neither can the floods drown it. In his book, Mere Christianity, C.S. Lewis wrote, "Do not waste your time bothering whether you love your neighbor, but act as if you did." As soon as we do this, we find one of the great secrets When you are behaving as if you love someone, you will presently come to love him. If you injure someone you dislike, you will find yourself disliking him more. If you do him a good turn, you will find yourself disliking him less. Church, we need to love. There are things that we need to do. There will always be decisions to make and things to do, even after your death. But church, we must do it all out of love. Paul sums up his entire epistle with this statement in verses 13 and 14. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong. Do everything in love. I'm going to end with that. Church, let's just not read these words. Let's live them. Father God, we thank you for this beautiful day, Father. We thank you for this wonderful opportunity, Father, to just gather in our houses, gather with family, Father God. Gather within the body of Christ, the eternal body of Christ, bound by love. Father God, we thank you that we can be edified, that we can glorify you, that we can celebrate you, that we can be with you, have a relationship with you, that we can pray to you and seek your guidance. Why? Not because we're good, but because you are good. You are the ever-loving, almighty God. And in your name we pray, amen.